Hi, I'm Pastor Ken Miller, and I'd like to invite you to Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church. We are a growing Spirit-filled congregation here in Sterling, Virginia, boldly proclaiming God's glorious gospel of grace, the finished work of the cross, and Christ's overwhelming love for you. More information is available at abidinglife.net. Come experience the power of God's Word at Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church. Join us Sunday mornings at 11 at Sterling, Virginia. Rivers of Living Water is a media outreach ministry of Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church in Sterling, Virginia. You can get information about this ministry at abidinglife.net or rolw.org. At our website, you can get information about our church, the media ministry, various outreach ministries, missions, our Bible college, and coming events. Join us on Sunday at 11 a.m. at 10 Pigeon Hill Drive, Suite 150 in Sterling, Virginia. Feel free to send me an email, pastor@abidinglife.net. Hi, I'm Pastor Ken Miller of Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church. It has been suggested to me that I not speak so much about the radical love of God because the word radical frightens people. It's not the church that's radical, it's God's love that's radical. What else can I call it? He took your sins, sickness, poverty, and fear upon His own shoulders and lavishes upon you His righteousness, health, provision, and favor. Yes, His love for you is radical. Join us at 11 a.m. Sundays in Sterling.
So when we think about repentance, metanoia, we want to repent to believe what? The same thing that God believes about you. You have the ability to do that. The Bible says that you have the mind of Christ. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, what is the mind of Christ? So how are we going to metanoia that stuff and undo it? We're going to cast up imaginations. We're going to have new imaginations about God and our relationship with Him and our oneness with Him. See, if we just say, oh, you know, I'm holy and blameless, what does that mean? That's not enough. We need to realize that, man, God's given you the permission to believe everything He's always felt about you.
The sweetest ones are, Father, forgive them.
We're celebrating grace, faith, and 500 years of Protestantism. This year, it's exactly 500 years since Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the church door, sparking a wildfire of spiritual enlightenment known as the Protestant Reformation. Saturday evening, October 28th, will be Grace Night, featuring the DC Grace Band and Frank Poitrone giving a message. Sunday, October 29th, at our Sunday morning church service, the DC Grace Band will lead praise and worship, and Frank Poitrone will give the sermon. Sunday evening will be Praise Night featuring the DC Grace Band and Lisa Fenstermacher. Monday, October 30th, will feature Roberts Leerden via video explaining the significance of Martin Luther. We'll wrap it all up on Tuesday, October 31st, with a family fun night. Instead of celebrating ghosts, witches, and fear, we've been granted the spirit of life, grace, peace, and joy. At our family fun night, we'll feature plenty of games, activities, lots of food, and a superabundance of candy. Mark your calendars. I hope to see you here.
Well, God said in the Old Testament he would command the blessings. And I said that we do that. God commands the blessings through our vocal cords, through our lips. So I think it's biblical for us to command the blessings. I command every seat here in this place to be filled in the name of Jesus. And I might touch on that a little bit in just a few minutes. But let's go ahead and go to the 1 John 3, verses 22 through 24. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave commandment. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us. Go back to verse 22. I thought he was going to have all three on one. Before I talk about this, I'm going to talk about this in just a minute. But first, let me reemphasize a few things that I shared last week. Last week, I shared with you the seven places, and actually there's more than those seven, but there's seven places that I talked about where Jesus basically gave you a blank check saying, ask for anything. And, you know, he didn't just say, ask for some things or ask for some specific things. He said, whatsoever you ask, or anything you ask, I will do it, or anything you ask the Father in my name, that I will do. So he wasn't being specific to certain requests. It was basically a blank check. And I called those the blank check scriptures. And I said, we need to start asking big. I could have included this one, except that this isn't directly out of the mouth of Jesus. This is John saying this, but he's saying the same thing Jesus said. Whatsoever you ask, whatsoever we ask, he's including himself, we receive of him. So this is another one of those blank check verses where he doesn't put a limit on it. He says, whatever you ask, we receive. You know, so this is something that is important for us to see. And, you know, as far as the commanding the blessings, you know, when I say I command every seat in this place to be full, or I command your body to be healthy, or I command this, or I command that, if I'm speaking it in agreement with God's word, then it's 100% biblical. And someone might ask, well, are you commanding God to do something? No, I'm not commanding God to do anything. You don't command God, of course. You don't command the holy angels. I don't believe in doing that. But I do believe that you can speak to your circumstances. And you can command your circumstances to line up with God's word. When I speak of commanding, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. Jesus said you could speak to the mountains and tell it to be cast into the sea. So you can speak to your circumstances and command your circumstances to line up with God's word. If your body is telling you that you're sick and God's word is saying that you're healed, command your body to line up with God's word. If your bank account says overdrawn, but God's word says you're prosperous, command your bank account to line up with God's word. Now, he might tell you that you need to do certain things in order to make that manifest, but you can command your situation to line up with God's word. Command opportunities to come your way where you can earn perhaps a better income so that won't happen. You know, but you can command your circumstances to line up with God's word. So that's what I mean when I talk about commanding the blessings. Now, some people bring up the idea. I've heard people say, yes, the Bible says whatsoever you ask, but there's the condition if you can keep his commandments. Now, doesn't that contradict some things that we've been teaching? Doesn't that contradict what Paul was teaching? And it absolutely does not. Because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Well, that sounds like John is teaching works, right? Is he teaching law and works? Well, you got to keep reading. And this is his commandment, that we should believe. Okay, so the commandment, and Jesus said this too. He said, this is my commandment, that you believe. And he also mentioned love. Okay, so in here, there's basically three things that I see that he's talking about. As far as the whatsoever you ask, you'll receive of him. He said, well, that we should believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ. So place your faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Place your faith in what Jesus did for you. Place your faith in the power of the name of Jesus. And keep in mind, every time that Jesus, or most of the times when Jesus said, whatsoever you ask, it shall be done, almost always he was saying, in my name. Remember that? We talked about that last week, that he said, whatsoever you ask the Father in my name. So that asking in the name of Jesus is important, having faith in the name of Jesus. And I talked a little bit about what that means last week. So there's basically three key words, in my opinion, in if you want to call it a condition. I don't know if you want to call it a condition or what, but in order to make verse 22 a reality for you, I think you need to get a grasp on what it means to believe. First of all, it means to have faith. Believe that God means what he says. He says he's not a man that he would lie. Believe that he means what he says. You know, there's some scriptures that just sound too good to be true. And so it's easy to talk yourself out of it, or allow other people to talk you out of it. But believe that God means what he says. Don't question it. Just believe it. Believe it. Accept it. Rely on God. Have faith. Okay, so another word for believe is to have faith. And he mentions love. If our faith is truly in Jesus, the scripture says he loved us first. And our love for other people is really just simply a reflection of his love for us flowing through us to other people. So I think faith is a key. Love is a key. Go to the next one now. Verse 24 tells us that it talks about abiding. Abideth. That also was something that Jesus talked in one of those blank check verses that I shared last week, that he said, if I abide in you and you abide in me, then you can ask whatever you will. So abiding in Jesus and allowing him to abide in us is significant. So the three keys that I see in here, now Stephen, you can go to that next one. The three keys are faith, love, and abiding. Faith, love, and abiding. How many here have faith in God? All right, every hand is up. That's awesome. And how many of you are allowing his love to flow through you to other people? Amen. I see all the hands up again. How many of you are abiding in Jesus? To me, that just simply means spending time in his presence. You know, that's what it means to me. Maybe it means something different to you. But when I'm spending quality time with him and he's spending quality time with me, I feel like I'm abiding in him and he's abiding in me. So if those three things, if you feel like you can identify with all three of those and you say, yes, I do walk in faith, or I do believe, I have faith in Jesus, I believe he means what he says, I'm allowing his love to flow through me, I'm abiding in Jesus, ask whatever you will, whatsoever you ask. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Think big, okay? So with that in mind, with that as a foundation, you know, last week I was urging you to think bigger. I was urging you to ask bigger. I was urging you to believe bigger. Today I want to share with you something specific that you should believe big about. I want to transition slightly into a different topic, but you know, I have a few more of what, you know, I spent several weeks talking about the glorious gospel of grace, and I still have a couple more sermons along those lines to share. But I'm going to put that on hold temporarily, because I actually was planning on teaching about the glorious gospel of grace. I was going to do a sermon, which I did before a year or so ago, Embrace His Grace, but I'm putting that on hold probably at least until next month. But I believe the Lord is leading me. It was Friday night. I just didn't feel peace in my spirit about doing that sermon. So I just started seeking God. Well, what am I supposed to do? If you don't want me to do that, what do you want me to do? And I believe the Lord is leading me to specifically focus on specific themes each month for the rest of this year. And there's 4 months left. This is the direction I think we're going. for the rest of this year. In September, this is the first Sunday of September. For the four Sundays of September, it's going to be healing, health, and wholeness, and longevity. I really meant to say healing, health, and longevity. That's the theme for this month. All right, so I want to urge you that if you have any health issues or if you know anyone that has health issues, and who among us doesn't know people with health issues? All of us know people with health issues, right? So be here and urge others to be here, because that's the theme for this month. I'm going to start with today. I've got a powerful message for you today that I believe is going to bless you and help you. And the next three Sundays, we're going to be focused on healing, health, and longevity. And straight from the scriptures, of course. Next month, it's going to be grace and the gift of righteousness. So I'll probably do a couple more sermons on grace and a couple sermons on righteousness and that type of thing. There's actually five Sundays in October, but Frank Quattrone will have the fifth Sunday, and I'm sure it'll be about grace. And, of course, that leads us into the Reformation celebration, all right, which is all about grace, too. So we're going to be focused on grace and the gift of righteousness in October. In November, praise, psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, and Thanksgiving. Of course, Thanksgiving is in November. So that whole month is going to be about praise, basically, in November. And then December, it's all about Jesus. Of course, there always seems to be a extra focus on Jesus, even by the world, you know, even by people who aren't necessarily in the church. There's more of a focus on Jesus than there is any other time of the year, probably. Anyway, so we're focused on healing, health, and longevity right now. I want to just encourage you, as I think everybody here knows, or at least you should know, because I've taught on this type of thing before, you don't have to suffer sickness. You know, I'm tired of Christians settling for less than what they've been promised by God. And I'm speaking about myself, too. I settle for less way too often. But if we see a promise in God's word, we need to grab a hold of it, believe it, and claim it as ours. I'm tired of the body of Christ settling for second best. It's time for the followers of Jesus to stop acting like victims all the time. It's time for us to rise up and take what's been given to us by our almighty, generous, gracious, loving Father. You know, he promised big things for us. So it's time for us to ask and believe big. When he says whatsoever, we need to believe that he means whatsoever. None of us are going to ask for anything bad, right? So whatsoever, I think, means whatsoever. So today specifically, I want to talk about, you already went there, I want to talk about longevity. You know, it doesn't matter what the lifespan was of your parents. You know, all four of my grandparents, or I will put it this way, none of my grandparents made it to 70. One died at 59, the other three died in their 60s. So, you know, I could look at that and in my mind think that's my fate, but I reject that because it doesn't matter. It doesn't change what God's word says. You know, it doesn't matter what the lifespan of your parents were or other family members. God has promised you long life. So are you going to believe what the world tells you or what your family tree tells you? Or are you going to believe what God's word tells you? It doesn't matter what your health is now or has been. Your health condition isn't. If it's not lining up with God's word, I want to encourage you to believe God's word even above what your circumstances tell you. He's a big God and he wants us to ask big. So let's go to Proverbs chapter. I'm going to share a few scriptures. There's actually a lot of scriptures that talk about long life, a lot of them. And I just picked out a few that I think make the point for us this morning, but there's a lot of others that we could look at, and maybe we will before the end of the month. But we'll begin with Proverbs chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. It says, "My son, forget not my law." Well, that sounds kind of legalistic, doesn't it? "But let thine heart keep my commandments." Well, what are his commandments? We just talked about that, believe or faith, yes. In some places you can see where it's faith and love, but it's always faith. He always, from a new covenant perspective, keeping the commandments is to believe that Jesus finished the work. He kept all the law on your behalf. He kept all the law on your behalf. That was you fulfilling the law in him. And then You know, so he lived that life for you, and then he died as you on the cross. So the ultimate sacrifice has been paid. Now the only commandment that you need to keep really is to believe. Believe that he did the work for you. Believe that he finished the work on your behalf. So don't let these scriptures about keeping commandments throw you off. Under a new covenant perspective, obeying Jesus is to trust him, to rest in him, to fully rely upon his finished work. What does it say when you keep his commandments? Length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. So if your faith is in Jesus, you're keeping the commandments. Length of days and long life. Doesn't that seem redundant? Isn't he just repeating himself? Length of days and long life. It sounds like the same thing. Length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Well, this kind of seems like he's repeating himself with those two phrases. And I kind of was wondering, why is he repeating himself? So I looked at a couple of other translations, and I like the New American Standard Version. It says in that phrase, for length of days and years of life. And I looked that up in the Strong's, and in fact, the in the King James, go back to the previous one, Stephen, where it says long, this word long, if you look up the Hebrew word, I didn't write out what the Hebrew word was, but it means years. So I don't know why King James translated it long, but years of life. Go back to in a New American Standard. This one is translated correctly. Length of days and years of life. Years of life and peace. It's one thing to have a long life, but if you're going to have a life of misery and sickness, that's no life, right? You know, I remember once that my wife told me this years before she got sick. I know she, most of you know, I think all of you know, she passed away 4.5 years ago. But long before that, probably a decade ago or so, we were talking. I was getting this revelation of longevity and claiming promises of long life. And she made a statement, well, I don't want to live to be old. I don't want a long life, which kind of surprised me that she would say such a thing. And so when I questioned her about it, she said, yeah, I don't want to be weak and sickly and having to rely upon other people and to be a burden on other people. I don't want that. But so her perspective of old age was different than mine. My perspective of old age is like Moses. Remember, Moses was 120, and the scripture says his eyes weren't dim. He was 120, and he climbed a mountain. You know, and God took him. I mean, he apparently died, but he died healthy. He died strong. You know, when we think of long life, don't think being frail and that type of thing. That's not, I don't think, God's best for you. Length of days, years of life and peace. So I believe this is telling us that yes, God wants to give you a long life, but it doesn't have to be a sick life. It doesn't have to be a weak life. It doesn't have to be a life of sorrow and depression and whatever else you associate with that. But he wants you to have a life where you're thriving, where it's years of life. You know, God can keep us in health and strength and full of strength all the days of our lives. So don't settle for Satan's lies. Don't settle for the devil's lies that you have to be frail, weak, and that your body is going to start breaking down at a certain age. I remember also when I was just turning 40 or in my early 40s, I was having a lot of stomach aches, a lot of stomach pains, ulcers maybe, or I'm not sure what it was, but it's gone now. But I remember having a lot of stomach cramps and stomach pains frequently. And I remember asking my mom, because my mom used to work at for several years, she was a nurse's aide. So I figured, well, maybe she can tell me what's going on. I didn't want to go to the doctor if I didn't have to. I was trying to walk by faith, trying to believe for healing. I asked my mom what she thinks this could be, and she didn't give me any diagnosis or anything. All she said was, well, you're in your 40s now, so you can expect pains in your body. You can expect things to start happening like that. And of course, I reject that because I know God's word well enough that I don't have to accept this. So whatever it is, I need to find out what it is and I need to overcome it, even if I don't find out what it is. I did eventually, a doctor once told me that he thought it was colitis, but I didn't actually go ahead and take tests to affirm that or anything, but it's long in my history, thank God. God's promises are sure. His word is true. He's not a man that he should lie, and we need to believe him. We just need to fully rely upon him. Now, some people, of course, will caution you about this word commandments, but just keep in mind what I would just say, whenever you see commandments as requirement, or if somebody brings that up, point them back to that verse we started with in 1 John 3, where it says, this is his commandment, that we believe. Yeah, so I just wanted to remind you the three things that we see in 1 John 3 is faith, love, and abiding. I think those are just three key words that you need to keep in mind. All right, so we have the promise of long life. The scripture we looked at a minute ago said that God promises you long life, years of life, years, length of days, and years of life. So how long is a long life? Well, let's look at Psalm 91, verses 15 and 16. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. How long is long life? I would say, if nothing else, don't stop until you're satisfied. Okay? I remember Kenneth Hagin saying that once. He said that if you ever see my name in the obituary, that means I'm satisfied. So he got satisfied at age 86, I think it was, if I remember correctly. So how long is long life? Are you satisfied yet? And there's a lot in the scripture that we could talk about, because this is another one of the scriptures where it says, call upon me and I will answer. So this is another one of the scriptures where he's saying, ask and I'll answer you. He's with you in trouble. He wants to deliver you if trouble comes your way. No matter what it is, whether it's a health problem or financial problem or family problem, whatever the trouble is, he wants to deliver you. And he wants to honor you and satisfy you with long life and show you my salvation. I think the last time I shared on this verse, I told you that the Hebrew word for salvation is Yeshua. So he wants to show you Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's always all about Jesus, praise God. And it's wrapped up in Jesus that he will satisfy you with long life. Now, many people have concluded, by the way, I think sometimes we credit this to David, but I think actually Moses wrote this, because Moses wrote Psalm 90. It tells us at the beginning of Psalm 90 that it's a psalm of Moses. It doesn't tell us who wrote Psalm 91, but usually we assume, and I don't know if this is always true or not, but we assume that if it doesn't tell us who the author is at the beginning of the psalm, we assume it is the same author as the previous psalm. So Psalm 90, Moses made a statement about 70 or 80 years. How many of you have ever heard, I know I did frequently, how many of you have ever heard God only promises 70 or 80 years, right? Have any of you heard people say that? Anybody here believe that? Oh, amen. Good. I'm glad. All right, well, let's take a look at that, because this is the scripture they get that from. Psalm 90, verse 10, the days of our years are 70, and by reason of strength, they be 80. In other words, 70, we know that means 70. 80 is 80. So it's saying people die at age 70, and if they happen to be strong, they make it to 80. If by reason of strength, they go to 80. Is this a promise? If it's a promise, let's finish this verse. Yet is their strength labor and sorrow. That doesn't sound like much of a promise, does it? For it is soon cut off and we fly away. Now Moses, when he wrote this, was approaching 100. And he ultimately lived to be 120. So he certainly isn't saying that 70 or 80 years is a promise. In the context, we should see this more as a complaint. He's saying, as they're going through the wilderness, these guys are dying off at age 70. The strong ones make it to 80. But their years are full of labor and sorrow. So he's not prophesying that this is God's will. He's lamenting that these are the facts, that this is what he's seeing. And if you look at the previous verses, we're not going to look at the whole chapter. There's a lot in this chapter. The previous verses, he talks about the circumstances that he's in. He expresses great frustration about some of the events of his day. And they were under judgment. We're not under judgment. let's make sure we understand that they were under the judgment of God. This is the children of Israel going through the wilderness, and they were under the judgment of God, but we're not under the judgment of God. We're under grace. Thank God for grace. Now, in the following verses of this chapter, Moses goes on and he's asking God to help us to number our days and grant us foresight to use our time wisely. He implores God for wisdom and understanding. So if the 70 to 80 statement isn't a promise, then how long should we believe for? Is there a number that we should shoot for? The main thing I would say is what he says in the next chapter, go until you're satisfied. But there is a better and more specific promise, I believe, in Genesis chapter 6, verse 3. Genesis chapter 6, verse 3, in the King James Version, it says, "And the Lord said, My spirit will not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years." The traditional view of this verse, again, this is one of those verses that I've heard in my younger Christian life. I heard this as a statement saying that it took Moses 120 years to build the ark. Have any of you heard that before? That it took Noah. Thank you. So I was just trying to see if you're paying attention. So it took Noah 120 years to build the ark. How many of you believe that? That's what I had always heard. And they base it on this verse. But this verse has nothing to do with Noah. It really doesn't. Because if this is saying 120 years to build the ark, it doesn't tell us where that 120 years began. Now, if there's going to be a prophecy saying it's going to take a certain period of time, in order to follow that prophecy or to understand the prophecy, you need to know where the timeline began, right? So I don't think it took Noah and his sons 120 years to build the ark. I don't believe that for a minute. I don't think this has anything to do with Noah. Noah is mentioned in verse 8. It says Noah found grace. It talks about different things happening and the giants in the land and different things going on and the corruption that was in the world and the judgment that was coming upon them, that God was ready to wipe everything out. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord in verse 8. But this is five verses before that. So I don't think this is something God is telling Noah. I think, and I believe, and I'm not the only one that believes this, that this is God telling us that your days, your years on this earth are to be 120 years. Now, that's not necessarily that everybody has to live exactly that amount of time. But you understand, before this, before the flood, they were living, how long did Methuselah live? 969, and many others lived 900 or 800 way up there. God was complaining, seemingly, that it's like the longer they live, the more corrupt they get. You know, I keep demonstrating grace upon them, but they just keep getting more and more corrupt. So he decided, well, I'm going to shorten their lifespan. See, this 120 years sounds like a long time for us, right? But for them, that's like a fraction of what they were living. Noah himself lived to, I think, 600 or right around there. So he's saying this almost as a judgment that if they don't get their life straightened out by 120 years, their time's up. You know, 120 years is enough for you to find favor with God or find the grace of God. 120 years, he's just shortening it down from the 900 some, whatever it was before. I heard someone say that the average, if you average all those years up, it was 860 or something like that. But, you know, we only have the lifespan of a few people mentioned. So whatever it was. Anyway, he's shortening the lifespan to 120. So let's look at another translation of this, the new Living Translation. Then the Lord said, My spirit will not put up with the humans for such a long time, for they are only mortal flesh. Now, he said they're only mortal flesh, but you know, you're not only human. You've got the power of God on the inside of you. So if they could live to 120 only mortal flesh, and you've got the power of God on the inside of you, certainly we can believe for this. Praise God. So they're only mortal flesh. In the future, this is what he's saying, in the future of that time, their normal lifespan will be no more than 120 years. Now, the normal lifespan, I want you to see that God, now this is the way it's worded in the New Living Translation, which truthfully, I don't really see the New Living Translation as a translation. Sometimes it just seems more like a paraphrase. But it's not a word-for-word translation. But this perspective of it, normal lifespan, 120 years. Normal. Now, so it took a few centuries, it took a few generations, but gradually the lifespan began to get less and less. And like I said, Noah lived to be 600 and something. Abraham, by the time it got down to Abraham, he lived to be, I think, 179 or something like that, 170 something. Sarah, I think, was 129. And I could get these wrong. I didn't look these up yesterday, but if I remember from previous study, I think Jacob lived to be 120 and Joseph lived to be 110. But there's several people in the Bible that lived to be right around 120. So 120 began, it took a few generations, but eventually the lifespan was shortened down to an average of 120. And that did become average for several generations. So the normal lifespan for a believer, I think, should be 120. Any of you ready to believe for that? Praise God. But you see, this is, if you see this as a promise of God, which I do, this is just as good of a promise as any other promise in Scripture. You know, for many centuries in the Bible, that was the normal lifespan. So I would say if you're 60, you're only halfway there. You're still middle age. Don't, you know, I hear people say, and I've heard people say, and I'm probably not from any of you, but I've heard people say when they're in their 40s, they feel like they're old, or they make comments about getting old. But 40s, 50s, 60s, and even 70s, I would say you're still middle-aged. Praise God. You're still middle-aged if you believe this, okay? So I think part of the problem is when we start thinking we're getting old, we start acting like we're getting old. Don't you think? If we think, well, my grandparents all died in their 60s, and now I'm 57. Wow. You know, but I'm aiming higher than that. I'm believing for more than that. And I'm not saying I will make it to 120 years, but I believe that this is a good goal to shoot for. I remember my mother saying that she kept saying, I'm going to make it to 100. She was trying to believe, anyway, that she was going to make it to 100, which would be a miracle if she did, because most members of my family have such a short lifespan. If she made it to 100, and I was believing with her, she made it only to 83. But for my family, that's a long life. When everybody else is dying in their 60s, she was able to believe for 83. Anyway, she was trying to believe for 100. But, you know, but think high, don't think low. Praise God. And I heard one person say, don't retire, but refire. Let's go on to, you know, we've talked, I remember, I think it was earlier this year, I did a sermon on call 911, emphasizing Psalm 91, verse 1. There's another 911, that's Proverbs 9:11. Proverbs 9:11. So this is another 911 to keep in mind. For by me, this is God speaking, for by me your days will be multiplied and your years will be added to you. By me your days will be multiplied and years of life will be added to you. So how do you get days to be multiplied? How do you do this? Well, you don't do it. It says, for by me. I should have capitalized that M. It's God speaking. It's not you that's going to do this. It's God that's going to do it. God says, by me. It's by him. So I'm not saying that diet and exercise aren't important. Certainly, you know, there's a place for everything like that. And this, Paul said, bodily exercise profiteth little. So the most important factor is the radical grace and relentless love of God. It's by him, trusting in his grace, relying upon his favor in your life. The most important factor is that you believe that God is the sustainer of life. Believe that he means what he says. Early death is never God's will. I remember, you know, when my wife passed away at age 53, and, you know, some people will say, well, it must have been her time. No, it wasn't her time. Early death is never God's will. I'm convinced of that. You know, sometimes it happens, but just because it happens doesn't mean that it was God's will. You know, people say, well, you just never know. Things happen, like the idea of storing up food in case of disaster. Some people say, well, you just never know. But God is faithful to his word even in the midst of tragedy, even in the midst of disaster. I believe with all my heart that you can take God at his word. And you might say, well, I tried it and it didn't work. Well, keep doing it. Keep believing. Keep trusting. Keep relying. Amen. Keep trusting him. So early death is never God's will for his people. And, you know, I believe with all my heart that you can live long. I believe this because the Bible says so, and I believe the Bible means what it says. I believe what the Bible teaches. And, you know, again, this is one of those things I would say that if it were only in one or two places, maybe we could dismiss it. But there are so many scriptures where he promises long life. And there's a lot that I'm not sharing with you, but there's a lot more. There's really a lot more than what I am sharing. Let's go on to Psalm 54, verse 4. God is my helper. The Lord is the sustainer of my life. So God sustains my life. I don't care what kind of symptoms come on my body. God is sustaining my life. I saw a statistic just yesterday that church attending Christians live an average of 7.5 years longer than everyone else. Shall I say that again? Church attending Christians live an average of 7.5 years longer than everyone else. So you'll live longer if you go to church. The truth of it is that there is a spirit of life in churches, or at least some churches, at least most churches. Perhaps there are some churches where you sense a spirit of death when they're preaching judgment and damnation all the time. But in many churches like ours, I believe, promote a life, you know, we're promoting life-oriented songs and life-oriented sermons. And the scripture says in Romans 8 that the law of the spirit of life has set me free from the law of sin and death. Sin is not of God. Death is not of God. He is the sustainer of life. Okay, so just how about if you say that? God sustains my life. He's blessing me with a long life. Praise God. So let's go on to Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 32. I'm going to try to speed up a little bit. I just glanced at the clock here, and I'm just in the introduction right now. So I'm just kidding. Look at this one. I have no pleasure in the death of him that dieth. You think God takes pleasure in death? Do you think God takes pleasure in what's happening in Houston? You know, tragedies, some people call them an act of God. They're not an act of God. You can call them, I don't care if you call them an act of the devil or an act of nature, but it's certainly not an act of God. But he says, I have no pleasure in the death of him that dieth, saith the Lord God. Wherefore, turn yourselves and live. Now, Jesus came to destroy death. So death should not have any part of your life, and not in your mentality. So he's certainly not going to use death to punish his children. So God has no pleasure in death. Now, I find that just an interesting statement because I think it's contrary to what some people think. But then he says you have to do something. Okay, so we're getting into works and law now. He says, turn yourselves. Now, turn, that kind of reminds you of what word? Repent, yes. Which means to turn or to change your way of thinking, really. So he's saying, turn yourselves. What I think he's saying, or the way I see this, is turn your thoughts away from death and turn your thoughts to life. Turn your way of thinking from illness and early death and things like that, and turn your thoughts and your speech to life. God has not predestinated a date and a time of death for you, I don't believe. So when he says turn and live, I think that he's, you know, I hear people saying sometimes it's killing me or my dad died of that, so I probably will too. Or, you know, people speak death all the time. Don't let yourself be speaking death. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. So he's saying turn from the thoughts of death and turn your thoughts to life. Turn your speech from speaking death to speaking life. So I think a secret to longevity really is to train your tongue to agree with God in every area of life. Stop agreeing with the devil. Stop speaking the problem and speak the promises. If you believe Satan's lies, you're giving him power over you. Jesus said that Satan came to steal, kill, and destroy, and that he, Jesus, came that you might have life and that you might have it abundantly, abundant life. So he wants to give abundant blessings on you. Let's see, I have one more scripture, I think. For he that will love life will see good days. Let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking no guile. So, for he that will love life. How many of you love life? Amen. He that will love life and see good. He's telling you basically what I was just saying. Let him refrain his tongue from evil. Now, by refraining your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking guile or evil, I believe he's saying part of the secret of longevity is to speak correctly. Stop speaking negative stuff. Stop speaking, he calls it evil, but stop speaking the problem and start speaking the promise. Okay, stop agreeing with the devil. Stop speaking the problem and speak the promise. If you believe the devil's lies, you're giving him power over you. I would just like to encourage you to do that. In fact, why don't we stand up for a minute? Stretch your legs a little bit. We're going to begin to close, but I want you to confess something with me. Say this with me. In agreement with this, we're not going to speak evil anymore. We're going to speak what God says. So say this after me. It is the will of God for me to be well, for me to be strong, for me to be healthy, for me to be pain-free, for me to prosper, spirit, soul, and body, mentally, socially, and financially. He wants me well. He satisfies me with a long life. A long, healthy life. And I take it. It is mine. And I command it to be so. All right, praise God. Let's go ahead and sit down, and I want to begin to transition into communion, which you can, if you're facing any kind of illness or sickness, you know, you can receive healing in communion. You know, in Leviticus, there were five offerings, and in the redemptive work of Jesus, he is the fulfillment of all five offerings. God's love was on great display when Jesus hung, carrying the weight of all your sin and your sickness and your diseases and your pains upon himself when he was paying the full price for each of us. So God doesn't ask you to clean up your act. He asks you to come as you are, and he gives you the free gift of righteousness. So, and if you're sick, come as you are, and he provides healing. If you're struggling financially, come as you are, and he becomes your provision. He said he became poor so you could be rich. So he will cleanse you. He'll heal you. Actually, I should say it in the past tense because it's already done. It was done 2,000 years ago. He's already cleansed you. He's already healed you as far as he's concerned. He's already made you whole. He's already prospered you. It's already done. Everyone who came to Jesus received their answer. Praise God. So what I want you to do is I think the way we've done this the last couple of times works pretty good. We're going to play a worship song. It's actually Amazing Grace, and I want you to ponder his amazing grace. How long is this song? About 4 minutes, maybe three or 4 minutes. So during this time frame, just come and take the bread and the juice and return to your seat, and after the song, we'll take communion together. So go ahead and play that. Thank you. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you." Now, this is not about remembering sin. It's about remembering Jesus. Jesus said, "In remembrance of me." So the stripes that Jesus took is unshakable ground for healing. So I don't care what it is or how many times you've tried to receive healing before, it's unshakable ground. He paid the full price, and I remember, I think it was Kenneth Copeland once said, it's a miscarriage of justice. If he took the suffering, it's a miscarriage of justice for me to suffer it also. He already took it for me. So all the help and all the health is in the redemption of Jesus Christ. By his stripes you were healed. So you do this in remembrance of him, meaning you do this in remembrance of what he accomplished on your behalf. And he took the pain upon himself, and he provides healing for you. He accomplished it for you. Repeat this with me. Say, "Thank you, Jesus."
Hi, I'm Pastor Ken Miller, and I'd like to invite you to Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church. We are a growing Spirit-filled congregation here in Sterling, Virginia, boldly proclaiming God's glorious gospel of grace, the finished work of the cross, and Christ's overwhelming love for you. More information is available at abidinglife.net. Come experience the power of God's Word at Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church. Join us Sunday mornings at 11 at Sterling, Virginia.
He raised me up when I was
So when we think about repentance, metanoia, we want to repent to believe what? The same thing that God believes about you. You have the ability to do that. The Bible says that you have the mind of Christ. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, what is the mind of Christ? So how are we going to metanoia that stuff and undo it? We're going to cast up imaginations. We're going to have new imaginations about God and our relationship with him and our oneness with him. See, if we just say, "Oh, you know, I'm holy and blameless," what does that mean? That's not enough. We need to realize that, man, God's given you the permission to believe everything he's always felt about you.
The sweetest ones are, Father, forgive them.
We're celebrating grace, faith, and 500 years of Protestantism. This year, it's exactly 500 years since Martin Luther nailed his 95 theses to the church door, sparking a wildfire of spiritual enlightenment known as the Protestant Reformation. Saturday evening, October 28th, will be Grace Night, featuring the DC Grace Band and Frank Poitrone giving a message. Sunday, October 29th, at our Sunday morning church service, the DC Grace Band will lead praise and worship, and Frank Poitrone will give the sermon. Sunday evening will be Praise Night, featuring the DC Grace Band and Lisa Fenstermacher. Monday, October 30th, will feature Roberts Leerdon via video explaining the significance of Martin Luther. We'll wrap it all up on Tuesday, October 31st, with a family fun night. Instead of celebrating ghosts, witches, and fear, we've been granted the spirit of life, grace, peace, and joy. At our family fun night, we'll feature plenty of games, activities, lots of food, and a superabundance of candy. Mark your calendars. I hope to see you here. Join us on Sunday at 11 a.m. at 10 Pigeon Hill Drive, Suite 150 in Sterling, Virginia. Hi, I'm Pastor Ken Miller of Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church. It has been suggested to me that I not speak so much about the radical love of God because the word radical frightens people. It's not the church that's radical, it's God's love that's radical. What else can I call it? He took your sins, sickness, poverty, and fear upon his own shoulders and lavishes upon you his righteousness, health, provision, and favor. Yes, his love for you is radical. Join us at 11 a.m. Sundays in Sterling. Rivers of Living Water is a media outreach ministry of Abiding Life Grace and Faith Church in Sterling, Virginia. You can get information about this ministry at abidinglife.net or rolw.org. At our website, you can get information about our church, the media ministry, various outreach ministries, missions, our Bible college, and coming events. Join us on Sunday at 11 a.m. at 10 Pigeon Hill Drive, Suite 150 in Sterling, Virginia. Feel free to send me an email, pastor@abidinglife.net.